Sarah, shall we start, or is there anyone else outside? We're ready. Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. A very warm welcome to CAS Business School. I'm sure all my colleagues have welcomed you today. My name is Michael Tsamvakis. I look after the students on the MSc in Energy, Trade and Finance. So some of you, hopefully, are going to see me during the course of the next year. I hope you're quite excited that you're going to be joining CAS. I'm not entirely sure what my colleagues told you about CAS, but the one thing I have to say is that there's quite a lot of work to be done during the next year. There's quite a lot of fun as well, and a lot of learning, but also quite a lot of work. So it's going to be a very tough year, but also a very fruitful year. So today I've put together a few things about energy, and particularly some of the major trends and challenges that we're facing, and also the opportunities. So it's a little bit on the energy demand side. And hopefully it's going to get most of you excited, because I'm trying to make it as relevant as possible to our everyday lives. I also want to take the opportunity to welcome anyone who's online currently, because I understand this session is actually broadcast over the internet. So we'll give the last few people who are coming in the chance to take a seat, and then we can get started. If you have a look at this picture here on the screen, it's a lovely picture of the world at night taken from NASA, and I find it very intriguing, not only because of the beauty that it has, but also because of the information it conveys. It gives you an idea straight away who are the countries, who are the people who have the lights on, and also very vast expanses of the globe which do not have any access to energy or very little access to electricity. And I'm going to mention some of these things in a minute. But I think the key thing for energy for us in the future circles around what a lot of policy makers now call the energy trilemma, which is a three-way problem regarding energy. And the first one is that we want what we call security of supply. So we want energy that we can source from parts of the world which do not have geopolitical issues, and we also have plenty of reserves left for them. And unfortunately, there's not a lot of energy commodities that can do that. Secondly, we want our energy to be affordable. We want to be able to pay reasonable prices to get our oil in our cars and our electricity in our homes. And this, again, is another challenge in the face of A, increasing demand, which we're going to see in a minute, and also scarcity of resources. You may have heard that we have about 60 years perhaps available for natural gas, about 45 or so years left over for oil, about 120 for coal. So we are looking not perhaps at an energy crisis, but we're looking at quite a lot more difficulty in sourcing the energy. And of course, where there are difficulties, there are also quite a lot of opportunities. The third aspect is what a lot of people call sustainability, and you must have heard it again in lots of different fora and the newspapers and so on and so forth. Some people look at sustainability as being able to moderate our use of resources and make them last for longer. A lot of people associate it directly with the impact that we have on the environment, so it's all about CO2 emissions. But one way or another, whoever is going to live in the next 50 or 100 years on the earth, they will have to face this. Whether you are a consumer yourself, whether you are someone who is involved somehow in the business of these energy resources, or whether you work in government and you are part of the very few that set the policy for the futures, these are the three key words for you to look out. So sustainability, affordability, and also security of supply. And just to show you the kind of challenges we face in the future, I start with demand. There's a picture for you that summarizes the last 50 years in terms of energy. This is something we call the world energy consumption, primary energy consumption, or primary energy demand. And this looks at every type of energy, whether it is oil or gas or coal or electricity or biofuels, anything which is translated into a common basis, which is known as the million tons of oil equivalent. So this gives you very quickly an idea of what we have been doing in terms of energy over the last 50 years. So since 1965, we have seen an almost uninterrupted continuous growth trend. You see, the blue area in the background goes up and up and up. And right now, we consume over 12.5 billion tons of oil equivalent. It's a little number worth keeping into your minds because you will compare it to what we have to face in the future, what is the demand forecast. You also see with on that graph the rate of growth of GDP. And in most cases it has been positive. We had a few occasions where it has been negative. And note the relationship between GDP and primary energy consumption. They go hand in hand. And throughout these last 50 years, if there were just a few events to summarize what has happened to the energy industry, it has been primarily geopolitical events, in many cases crises. So in 1973 you had the first oil price shock, with the price of oil climbing from $2 to $10 a barrel. And then only a few years later, in 1979, you had the Iranian Revolution and the Iran-Iraq War, a second major oil price shock from $10 to $40 a barrel. And then later on, in this 50-year history, you had the collapse of the Soviet Union that brought about major geopolitical changes around the world, particularly in Europe. And again, it had a serious effect on energy. And in fact, what is now Russia and several of the former Soviet Union republics are extremely important players in the energy scene. And then you had, in 1997, the Southeast Asian financial crisis that had an impact on the rate of energy consumption, particularly in that part of the world. It affected it negatively for at least a couple of years. And then what we have experienced since the 2000s is the continuous ascent of developing or emerging economies led by countries such as China and India and several others, particularly in Asia Pacific, but also in Latin America. So we had an almost uninterrupted growth. Not only that, the actual rate of growth has increased. It has stepped up, especially from 2003. And then, of course, what we all remember was the third, fourth quarter of 2008 that had an impact on the energy markets during the rest of that year and throughout 2009. So world economic growth went down, became negative, and also we had that little blip in primary energy consumption that also went down. But apart from that, the trend throughout these 50 years has been of increased energy consumption. And where is this more and more energy and more accessibility to energy at affordable prices in the face of declining natural resources? How are we going to to resolve this? And I'm not here to give you any answers. I'm here to pose quite a lot of questions. Hopefully you will be the ones who will go out and find the answers within a business, from a business perspective. So, what have we had so far? Almost uninterrupted growth, dotted with quite a few political events. And political events are the bread and butter of the energy business, whether it is the Ukraine fighting with Russia, or whether it is the interruption of production from Libya, or whether there is the disruption, if you like, that shale gas and tight oil from the United States are bringing to the energy industry. There are always developments in terms of politics, in terms of technology, and so on and so forth, that make the energy scene a particularly interesting area to be in. So quite a lot of politics, economic events, and also technology developments. What do we get out of this? If you look around at the various agencies that try to give us a picture of the future, almost everyone is looking at about, or forecasting, about 40 to 50% rise in demand between now and 2035, so essentially in the next 20 years. If you want to put it in terms of how much oil we consume, as a world, we now consume almost 90 million barrels of oil on a daily basis, 90 million barrels per day. And in the next 20 years, this will climb probably closer to 110. So we have to find almost another quarter of what we produce right now to consume. Right? So just as an example, using oil as an example, you see what a kind of a major challenge we have in front of us. So rising demand all around and various challenges associated with this rising demand. First of all, you have, for example, the big discussion about climate change. Is anything going to happen? Are the nations going to find a consensus from 2015 onwards? Are we going to have new policies which are going to restrict the amount of energy we can consume? Or indeed, the type of materials, whether it's going to be fossil fuels or something else, that we will be able to continue consuming if we want to decrease the impact that we have on the Earth's climate and the climate change which we are all experiencing in one way or another. At the same time, we have reserves which may be depleted, or if they are increasing, they are increasing at a very slow rate. And also what we keep getting is what we call more difficult reserves. So reserves which are a lot more expensive to develop. So a lot of people will tell you that we have plenty of oil and gas left and we can continue developing it as long as the price is right, i.e. the oil and the gas are quite expensive. But this also poses a challenge for financing. Okay, the amount of financing that is required to develop these reserves comes in the hundreds of trillions on a worldwide scale. And it's not just reserves of fossil fuels, it's also electricity networks, expanding electricity to hopefully perhaps to all people around the world. So financing and investment is extremely important. We do have some new technologies and they are coming in. We have since 10 years ago a lot more wind generation, a lot more solar power, a lot more hydroelectricity, but they all come at a certain cost. If you look at the price of producing electricity using wind, which is very welcome, it is also very expensive. On the basis of something called the levelized cost of electricity generation, it is one of the most expensive forms of producing electricity together with solar power. So again, fossil fuels remain the most economical. And they bring with it renewables, they bring other challenges. The fact that they are interruptible. The wind is not always going to blow at the time that you want it to blow, and the same happens with the sun. So you have to put a lot more investment in making this renewable energy non-interruptible or continuous, if you like. You have, of course, the continuing development of geopolitics as we speak. We have developments happening all over the world, no less in Europe. Of course, we have the big challenge that over the next 20 years, we expect another 2 to 2.5 billion people to inhabit the Earth. So you have this big underlying trend of much, much higher population. And in addition to this, a population which has an increasing income and has changing tastes and wants higher rates of energy consumption. And in addition to this, at the other end of the spectrum, you have currently about 1 billion people with no access to electricity. And even more than that, with no access to rudimentary refrigeration and sanitation facilities. So you have a very big problem on energy poverty, and at the same time, you have all these other changing tastes and increasing trends in population growth. And also, you have a sort of a two-speed energy demand growth. One is the OECD economies that have reached a certain level of maturity, and although they will increase in terms of energy production, they will be almost flat. And on the other hand, you have the developing economies, the emerging economies that are developing right now. And the first thing that they would like is bigger access to energy, higher per capita energy consumption. So a lot of this energy growth over the next 20 years is going to come from these nations. So if you want to put this in a nice picture, this is the development of energy consumption so far. You see the development from the 1990s to 2013. So we currently stand at about 2.5 billion tons of oil equivalent. And every single research organization, starting with the US Energy Information Administration and following on with the International Energy Agency, they all give the same story. In their base case scenarios, energy demand over the next 20 years is going to increase by about 40 to 50%, probably to around 18 or 19 billion tons of oil equivalent. So 12.5 to 18. This is a kind of a headline figure you're looking at. The International Energy Agency produces a couple of more scenarios about how this growth is going to come. So they have a very pessimistic scenario which assumes a lot more controls on CO2 emissions and a halting or a reversal of the climate change that's currently happening, which is the only scenario under which energy demand is going to grow at a much, much slower pace. But everything else, if we continue with business as usual, as it is now, we're looking at this 40 to 50% increase in energy demand. And then who is going to generate this demand? This is what you get in terms of OECD economy, so a very, very marginal growth in energy, which is really minimal if you look at it on a year-by-year basis. And then the vast majority of demand coming from the developing nations. You see, they generate pretty much. Now, from a business perspective, this simply tells you these are where the growth opportunities are. Okay, these are the economies that are going to generate business for those who produce energy, who trade energy, who are retail distributors of energy, whatever it is. So, if we have a look to see where energy comes from, we still rely very much for about 87% of our primary energy, it is still fossil fuels. We have oil and natural gas liquids, which account nowadays for a third of energy. They used to be about 40%. So the reliance on oil is coming down, but the pie that you see there gets bigger and bigger every year. So as a result, oil also grows, but at a much slower rate. So although the importance, the significance, very slowly diminishes, the actual business generated by oil also increases, particularly in the emerging economies that have not had the time yet to develop the sources of consumption of oil, which is primarily transportation. So car ownership, for example, or aviation, etc., these sectors have not really taken off and have not matured as much as they have in OECD economies. So there's plenty of growth to come from then. And then you have the remaining 30%, which comes in the form of, for example, nuclear generation. And right now, we're not entirely sure what we want to do with nuclear. Some nations are against it, others just continue having it. A few nations are actually steaming ahead with it, increasing the amount of nuclear capacity that they have. We have hydroelectricity, which is not without controversy. It is the largest source of renewable energy, but it usually means big investments and at the same time big disruption in the places where you actually put a massive hydroelectric dam. So it is not without controversy. And then of course you have renewables, and although this is the fastest growing energy sector and it has tripled in business over the last 10 years, yet it only makes up for 2% of primary energy consumption. A little bit more if you look at it only from the point of view of electricity, which is about 4%. But if you look at it in the bigger pie, which is the energy consumption, then you see it's only 2%. And this includes everything, wind, solar, geothermal, biomass, it includes biofuels, anything you can imagine. You lump it all together, you just make up 2% of primary energy consumption. So there is still quite a lot of development there, but not without obstacles, not without problems. And then if you look at who is actually accounting for this consumption, you will see on the one hand you have the very mature economies of the UK, of the US, North America in general, and then Europe, and this includes both what we call Europe and Eurasia, so Europe and the former Soviet Union republics, and Europe includes not only the EU but also the European Economic Area. So it's quite a large block, and together they make up for each one of them nearly a quarter of primary energy consumption, about 45% together. And then you have the next big slice, which is Asia. And this includes Asia, South Asia and Asia Pacific. So you have there the two big powers now, powerhouses, which are China and India, and they're the one coming up with quite a strong demand for energy in all forms. And then in addition to this, you have a Middle East, which is growing. It is a very, very big producer of oil, of course, and gas, but it is growing in importance in terms of consumption because of the population increases, because the taste change, lots and lots of interesting things happening there. And then you have South America, which is also rising fast, although the rate of growth has slowed down a little bit in the last few years. And eventually you have Africa, which, given the size of the continent and the population that it has, it makes a very small impact in terms of consumption, but it is an extremely interesting area for a lot of investors in terms of exploration and production, particularly for oil and gas. So there's a lot of activity all over West Africa, a lot of exploration now in East Africa, and a lot of these cargo flows are finding their way into the developing nations, nations of Asia and Asia Pacific. Just to give you a quick idea of who consumes what, this is Europe, and you see how Europe is now pretty much flatlining in terms of energy demand, in terms of energy consumption. You'll see some of the big chunks which are taken by some of the main, the three or four large EU nations like Germany, Italy, France, the UK, and also by Russia and some of the former Soviet Union republics. They're also accounting for quite large amounts. But you see it pretty much flat lines. In fact, energy consumption came down after 1990 and has failed to pick up in a major way. And the overall long-term outlook for this part of the world is that it's going to be flat, if not declining. And this is where our energy comes from in Europe. So you see still very much dependent on oil and quite a lot of coal still, natural gas, but a little bit of a bigger impact in terms of renewables, particularly if you only look on the western side of Europe, where renewables share is actually larger, it's approaching 8%. And then if you look at the United States, again you see quite a strong growth through the 1990s and a bit of the 2000s, but now demand growth is a lot more moderate. And despite the fact that last year we had a bit of a blip with the United States growing in terms of energy consumption, on a long-term basis, this is a part of the world where we're looking to get a lot more energy efficiency. So oil, for example, which is going to be used at a lower rate because the efficiency of the cars and vehicles in general is improving. So the forecast that it's going to be slow or flat energy growth. And then you have the share again, quite a lot of oil, natural gas, coal, a lot less renewables, some hydroelectricity and so forth. And of course nuclear. And then you have South America, South and Central America, a major growth area. The biggest impact, of course, there is made by Brazil because it is the biggest energy consumer and it has large amounts of hydroelectricity, for example. Has started drilling now offshore. They have a massive reserve there of oil. And again, you see here the various amounts of energy resources which are used. Then you see the Middle East. You see that growth is continuing to, that pattern is continuing to go in exactly the same direction. So the Middle East is a major consumption area, business area. And as you see, very little other than oil and gas there. Okay, consumption is dominated by these two. Africa, of course, some growth, but starts from a very small base and it's still the smallest of all the major regions that we see. Still very much driven by fossil fuels, extremely rich in fossil fuels as well. From coal in South Africa to oil in Nigeria, Angola, to natural gas again in Nigeria, Algeria, and so forth. And then we have the major region where we've seen absolutely phenomenal growth. And as you will see here, there in the middle of the graph, that big blue area in the middle, which is China and how it has expanded over the last the series there go from about 50 years. But the major thrust of the expansion has been from 2000 onwards. And this is set to continue. And again, you will see the two major economies in terms of energy consumption, which is China and India, both of them are very much driven by coal to a very large extent. An even larger percentage when you look at electricity generation, which is most of the coal goes. If you look over the last about 20 years, 23 years, who has contributed to the extra demand for energy, you will see that the major contributor, especially in the last 10 years, has been China, followed by India, and then eventually by the rest of the world. So again, the point I made earlier in terms of new business, this is where people look at. That's why a lot of people are setting up shop in Southeast Asia, trying to take advantage of the opportunities created there. How do we consume energy? In a very, very different way. If you look at places like Saudi Arabia, United States and Canada, each person consumes more than 7 tons of oil equivalent per year. But there are parts of the world, large parts of the world, where you don't even consume half a ton of oil equivalent. As I said, there's 1 billion people that are officially in energy poverty. They don't have access to energy which is secure, for example, or where it's affordable or easy to get access to, etc., etc. A lot of them do not have any electrification. We are doing a better job in consuming this energy a lot more efficiently, and this shows you how much energy we consume measured against how much income, how much GDP we actually generate. So these are kilograms of oil equivalent per $1,000 of GDP that we generate in various parts of the world. And you see China, for example, consumed energy a lot less efficiently, but as time has passed and as technology has come into place, then this is improving. But again, you see it's not as low as in some of the other nations we see. And where does electricity, or rather energy, go to? A lot of it in industry, a very long list of the various industrial sectors that use energy. We have, of course, transportation, where the vast majority of energy is generated by refined oil products still, although biofuels are making some impact in some countries. Mostly we rely on things like diesel and gasoline for our cars and trucks, and aviation turbine fuel or jet kerosene for our planes. So biofuels still have a relatively small impact there. And then we have, of course, quite a lot of places like this, commercial buildings, public sector buildings, residential consumers who rely on the consumption of effectively gas, electricity, and in some cases oil. And collectively we make a very big impact. Each one of these sectors accounts for about a quarter of primary energy consumption. And then we have other sectors like agriculture, for instance, and things like the petrochemical industry, where the use of oil is not for energy purposes, it's just to change oil into the various types of plastics. So this is a very broad overview of what energy we consume, where we're going to from here, and also in which various activities energy is consumed. And I have a few more slides which looks a little bit at supply only for the two major commodities, and this is oil and gas. Oil because it still generates the largest part of primary energy consumption, and gas because it is the most promising one. It is the one that a lot of people say it is going to be the bridge fuel between now and what will happen in 20 years, where hopefully we will have transitioned in an economy which has a lot more renewables and a lot less coal. So a lot of people are looking to gas, not only for direct consumption for heating, for example, but also increasingly for a lot more electricity generation. So if we look at oil, here is oil, as I said, we're not running out of reserves. Year after year after year, we have an increase in reserves. A small increase, but it's an important increase. But the problem is a lot of the oil increasingly comes from difficult sources, sources which are very deep offshore, sources located in the Arctic Circle, types of oil which are very difficult to move around and refine. Things like, for instance, the very heavy bitumen that you find in the Orinoco Belt in Venezuela, or the oil sands in Canada. Oil which requires a lot more investment to extract from shale, like the tight oil or shale oil that currently is having a boom in the American market, but requires a lot more effort, a lot more technology, and as a result it comes at a higher cost. if you look who produces the oil, it's almost equally split between OPEC and non-OPEC countries, so OPEC still has a major role to play. These 11 nations that make up the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, all of them are in the top 20 producers of oil. You have another 42% that comes from non-OPEC members, and finally the last block, another 16%, which comes from Russia and other former Soviet Union republics, particularly Kazakhstan and Azerbaijan and a few others. We also see that in terms of reserves, the vast majority of reserves is actually found in one part in the world, and this is the Middle East. And it's not only that the reserves are plentiful there, they are also relatively the cheapest to extract. Okay, to extract oil in Saudi Arabia or Kuwait, for example, or other countries in the region, you probably need to spend about $2, $3, $4 perhaps per barrel in exchange for a price of over $100 a barrel. To extract a barrel of tight oil in the United States, you may need to spend anything between $50 to $80. To do the same thing in the Arctic, we don't know yet. We're at the exploration stage, but definitely one of the most expensive. Again, to extract oil from the deep offshore of Brazil, something similar. The amount of investment that has to go there to make it possible makes the extraction, the production of oil quite expensive. So as I said, we have still lots of oil, but increasingly it comes from difficult places like the oil sands in Canada and so forth. And difficult also in terms of the environmental impact. Okay. This is just a picture of who are the world's largest oil producers. So you see there, the world is topped by Saudi Arabia, which is something that you would expect, followed by Russia, and followed very closely by the United States. Last year, the US increased its oil production by 1.1 million barrels per day. It was the largest increase which has been recorded in the US since the 1970s, when it reached the minimum point, if you like, in terms of production. So the US is making a serious comeback, and it is threatening perhaps to produce more oil than Russia at some point. The big question mark is it going to last for a long time? Is it something that will last for the next 30 years or something that will peter out in the next 10 years? Okay, so there's always a big question mark with regard to this more difficult oil reserves. And then you see that oil is a commodity that moves easily and quite a lot about, moving around in very large tankers from 300,000 tons at a time, which is about 3 million barrels, all the way down to 500,000 barrel parcel sizes. And it moves from major hubs in from the Middle East, for example, from West Africa, but also it moves through pipelines. So quite a lot of the oil that comes down from Russia into the Western Europe, Western European countries, comes via a network of pipelines. And of course, you have quite a lot of activity nowadays, quite a lot of flow of oil that goes towards Asia-Pacific. More than 60% of the Middle Eastern exports go to Asia-Pacific, Japan, South Korea, China, and all the Southeast Asian countries. Quite a lot of West African crude oil production has now diverted away from the US and towards Asia-Pacific as well, because of this development in the US with their own light sweet crude oil. So we see major changes in trading patterns. Even more complicated are the trading patterns of refined oil products. I won't even go there in terms of slides, but we've had seen major changes in terms of refining capacity around the world. A lot more refineries now in the Middle East. Chinese refining capacity has doubled in the space of 10 years. Indian one has increased probably by about a third in the same period of time. European refining capacity has been going down. Refineries here have been closing down. Okay, so we've seen major shifts, if you like, in where we get the oil from, where we refine it, and whether it is close or far away from the final market. Again, this translates into very interesting opportunities in terms of trading the commodity, of moving the commodity around. Natural gas, another interesting case. You don't have an OPEC for natural gas, but you do have reserves which are concentrated in three or four major countries. So nearly 60% of reserves excuse me, are in Russia, Iran, Qatar, and Turkmenistan. And all of them are big players in the market, with the exception of Iran, who is not an exporter. It produces quite a lot, but it's all for internal consumption. But Russia is the world's biggest exporter. Qatar is the largest LNG exporter, i.e. gas in liquefied form. So you see, in terms of reserves, again, gas is not uncontroversial, because you can find it in parts of the world that potentially you can have geopolitical issues, and we are having them right now in Europe with respect to Russian gas supply. It is relatively concentrated in terms of reserves. And also, it is quite a fragmented market in terms of pricing. And the reason is because gas does not flow that easily and that inexpensively as oil does. So you have to move gas either by spending quite a lot of money to put the capacity in place to liquefy the gas and ship it in tankers, or you have to lay a pipeline. And both types of transportation are expensive and also fairly inflexible, as opposed to oil trade that changes quite easily. So you have a very different market, is the natural gas market, from oil. Here you see the major producers of gas, and again you see the big, big role played by the United States. The interesting thing is, about a third now of this gas that you see there is shale gas. You will all have heard about shale gas, the big revolution that happened from 2005 onwards in the United States. Lots and lots of gas that comes from very difficult substrate of soil, the shale, which is like very thick mud that you have to break it up and then pump quite a lot of mud, water, and a long list of chemicals in order to push that gas and extract it. But it has made a huge, huge impact in Europe, and particularly in the United Kingdom. You are looking a lot more closely at using a lot more shale gas. Again, partly because of the geopolitics and the current uncertainty with regard to the continued supply of Russian gas to Europe, especially with the Ukrainian situation. So again, we go back to the very original problem, one of the legs, if you like, of the trilemma, which is security of supply. So you'll see business models developing in order to address this, this aspect. And again, if you look at gas trade, quite actively traded, not as large as oil, but we have quite a lot of gas that travels into pipelines, and these are the red flows there, and also quite a lot that travels in LNG from Qatar, from West Africa, from North Africa as well. You will see also flows from Southeast Asia, and of course Qatar, which is the biggest Middle East exporters. And a lot of it find the way primarily into the Asia-Pacific market, where you have one country that dominates all the LNG imports, and this is Japan. A very big producer, very big consumer, sorry, of natural gas. And again, this is another example where a natural disaster happens, which has implications on the energy supply for this country, and I'm talking, of course, about Fukushima. And again, it has a huge impact on the market, on the demand for natural gas and coal in that case, and as a result, on the price of the commodity. So, what are the implications for you? Well, the environment in terms of energy that we are living, we're going to live in, and we're going to work in, is a lot more challenging. On a personal basis, we have to rethink about our footprint and about our energy consumption. When all of us came to CAS this morning, we never thought for a minute that is the bus going to run because, you know, there's no shortage of gasoline. To sit in this theater, you know, you expect all the lights to be on, the projectors to be running, all of this spend quite a lot of electricity, consume a lot of electricity. So we don't give it a second thought. But a lot of people are talking about a looming energy crisis, an inability to produce enough electricity to have available all the time, if at the same time we do not want to use coal to produce that electricity because it's too dirty. Where is the capacity going to come from? Again, energy and climate change is here to stay, unless suddenly the collective knowledge that we have from the climate scientists changes and we decide that all of that was just, you know, scary talk and climate change doesn't actually exist. I think all we're going to see is climate change being higher and higher on the political agenda, and it permeates, it trickles down to all the different aspects of business. The way we consume energy, the way we produce it, and the way we move it around as well. It has an impact in all aspects. What do we get with regard to where is the energy going to come from? The consensus is that fossil fuels are still going to be big. So we're still looking perhaps not at 87%, but we're looking at 80% of the world primary energy coming from fossil fuels. So what we expect is that oil is going to still be big, soy is going to be gas, coal perhaps is going to tone down a bit. Perhaps it is going to a sort of a longer term decline. But there is plenty of scope for the industry, if you like, to grow. And for the industry to grow, it will need a lot more of you, basically. A lot more of people who are willing to engage with the industry, and these are not necessarily just people coming from an engineering or science background, it's also people coming with a business education that understand about procurement, about pricing, about risk management, about hedging, for example, exposures, and so on and so forth. So they require quite a lot of what I call young blood to run the existing business, but increasingly a lot more people with an entrepreneurial spirit that are willing to risk more things, perhaps for high rewards, in new areas of technology. Take technology from the lab and put it in practice. Okay, take that renewable technology, that storage technology, for example, for electricity, and turn it into a venture and be able to sell it and hopefully make lots of money more out of it, but at the same time, offering, if you like, a solution towards the energy trilemma. So the other thing, which is a very fortunate thing, is the sources of demand and supply tend to be quite far away from each other. So there is a very, very active trade out there. If you look at it from the point of view of seaborne trade, because shipping does come into the energy trading as well, crude oil and oil products is the largest commodity which is traded by sea. And then it is followed by coal, and then it's iron ore. We go to dry bulk commodities. Okay, so the two largest, or the three, if you like to put them as three largest groups of commodities traded on a worldwide basis, have to do with energy. Okay, so it's still very important. And because of that, there are plenty of opportunities in the industry to work in various roles. And I have put a few here. For example, you could work anywhere from the upstream production, okay, all the way down to the downstream distribution, retail, marketing, and so on and so forth. We're trading in between transportation, but also roles that have to do with policy making. Okay, so it may not be necessarily only business, it may be business focused, but from the point of view, for example, a government agency or a governmental organization. And also, what you have is the various companies which are involved in the sector. And some of them you are familiar with because they are the very big oil and gas companies, the ones that provide us with our daily consumption of electricity and gas and oil products and gasoline, etc., etc. But there are also quite a lot of companies there which are not that well known to the general public. They may be known to you if you read the Financial Times on a daily basis. The big trading houses or commodity houses, the transportation companies, for example. There are quite a lot of financial intermediaries which are still involved in the commodity business. It is true that several of the big banks have moved out of commodities for regulatory reasons. There are not that many banks as they used to be 5 years ago, but it doesn't mean that the commodity business and the energy commodity business in particular has gone out of fashion. They've just moved it to a parallel market where they have a lot more flexibility to do financing, where they can converse, if you like, with people from the industry who understand the risks a lot better rather than having to deal with government regulators. So there are still opportunities for commodity financing, whether you are trading as part of a hedge fund or whether you are doing commodity trade finance and anything else. And of course, again, there are some positions for government, because the energy trilemma that I posed at the beginning is actually at the very front, at the very top of the agenda of many, many different countries, whether it is the US or whether it is China, whether it is most of the European Union members, or whether it is South America or Southeast Asia, and so on and so forth. I think these three main issues remain major issues for everyone. Right, I think all I have is about an hour, and I have to leave you some time for questions. So for now, I thank you. And do you have any questions? Absolute silence. Nobody wants to ask everything. Can I take a quick show of hands? How many of you are proposing to come either to the energy or the shipping degree? Okay. And how many to the general finance degrees? Okay, quite a few of you. If any of you like and are interested in the energy markets, I do run an elective in the third term, which is called exactly that, energy markets. So it's a sort of a brief version of what primarily the energy students go through the core part of their course. Okay, so they cover energy in a lot more detail. But if you look at sort of a very quick idea of what's happening, what are the key markets, things like the ones you saw here, but expanded to all the energy commodities, all the way from oil and gas to electricity and renewables, then you have the opportunity to do it in the third term. For the energy and shipping students, one way or another, you will cover it in your core course. Yes, sir.
Is that the module taught in Dubai?
Not anymore. It's not going to be taught in Dubai. It's going to be taught here. Yeah. Dubai is too hot for everyone. I just came back from there, and I think it will work better if we do it here from next year. Something else will probably be taught in Dubai, but it won't be energy markets. Any other questions? Yes.
Is there quite a lot of overlap with the shipping and energy course then?
Which one?
Is there quite a lot of overlap between shipping?
Between the two courses? Yeah. 6 of the 10 core modules are the same. They're all the finance and quants courses. The remaining are separate. You have 4 different core modules. Okay, the one is more focused on energy and primarily energy and energy trading. The other is doing a lot more in terms of shipping and shipping finance. You both do the same transportation. Okay, the same shipping, almost the same. Yeah?
So, if the focus of energy is shifting towards the renewable energy, does that mean the movement or transportation or trading between countries is going to slowly decline as well? Because we really have to transport renewable energy, isn't it?
No, but what you need to remember is that renewables may double, triple, whatever it is, but it will still account for a very small amount. And also where renewables go is directly into electricity. So as long as they replace coal, for example, there will be an impact on coal. But they won't be able to replace until there is a major shift in technology, things like transport fuels. Okay, so this is a big problem.
But then renewable energy can only be moved around countries by like direct electricity links.
You can, provided you have the money to invest in making the networks a lot more interconnected, which is another issue for electricity networks. So it can happen in Europe, for example. Can happen in the United States. It is not happening right now. So what you have in Europe is large units generating renewable energy in, say, Germany, the UK, Spain, the Scandinavian markets, but the degree of interconnectivity with very large wires, basically, between the very large cables between the countries has not happened to the extent that the EU itself would like it to happen. So there are limitations. To give you an example, the UK is connected to Holland and also to France with interconnector cables. The Dutch one is 1 gigawatt and the French one is 2 gigawatt. The UK consumes anything between 35 to 55 gigawatt. So even if France and Holland says you can have all the electricity you like, you wouldn't be able to pass it through the cables because the interconnectivity is still quite long. So you still have kind of inflexibility.
What's your opinion to new nuclear energy in the next 20 years, 30 years in Europe?
I think it's, to be honest, the major problem there in the major problem with nuclear energy comes from two main nations, and this is France and Germany. And the one says yes, the other says no. Right? So France produces 70% of its electricity from nuclear and wants to continue doing that, but has a major issue refinancing nuclear power stations that are about 30 to 35 years old. So it will come down to financing again. And right now, with the tightness of finances around Europe, the government does not have plentiful money to give to projects, which, by the way, overrun their budget and overrun the delivery time. Okay, so nuclear power stations are not easy to finance. In Germany, they have made a decision that they're going to shut down nuclear. But then again, the government may change in 5 years and they may reverse that decision. So the gist of it is that it's a highly political issue, nuclear. And here again, it's the same thing. Eventually, this government decided to go ahead with one, at least with one plan to go ahead and install new nuclear capacity. And it has been slated by everyone that it's guaranteed huge profits for the people who build a nuclear power station. It has guaranteed a price which is more than double the current electricity price and so on and so forth. So basically it's an area where not a lot of companies will go unless they get big government guarantees. So if the government has a lot of money, they may be able to provide it. Okay, so the answer is, I don't know. Okay, simply as that, because it depends very much on a government that changes every 5 years but is required to make a 50-year decision ahead. And as you know, governments are not very good at making these decisions. Yeah.
With the excellence you mentioned of sort of energy trading and financing and banking, what's the engagement of CAS Business School itself with the new energy companies that have come out of that and their sort of coming to the market? I saw Glencore on there. Who else are you?
Glencore is not a new energy company. Glencore is a commodity trading house.
I saw Glencore on there as one of the commodity trading houses that you have.
Yeah.
Who else do you guys directly focus on?
All the trading and energy houses, including Trafigura, Mercuria, Vitol, Louis Dreyfus, anybody who's in the commodity business in general. And a lot of them, if they are in commodities, they will do primarily energy and metals. So with all of them basically have come to us, have recruited from us, we have some of our room right there. The others can be oil majors or smaller energy companies. We also get quite a lot of people who go back to work for national oil companies because of where they come from. So today, for instance, the representation you have is not quite representative of what we're going to get in class. Right? Some of them go into the transportation aspect of energy, to work in shipping effectively, but with energy shipping. So it varies.
And will they all be attending the careers fair?
No, not all of them. Because not all of them like to be next to each other. You may get one or two companies. Career fairs is not the best way to actually find a job. A career fair is good to give you an exposure, to get a few cards, to try your skills, to put yourself in a more professional outlook if you like and talk to somebody. But this is not where people are going to hire you from. And a lot of companies shy away from that because they don't want to be with a competitor in the same room. And they prefer to come and give you an individual presentation, which happens later on. Okay, we get quite a few alumni, particularly in the first term, who come in from some of these companies and they come and give career talks. You don't necessarily always want to talk to the HR either, because they will give you just the corporate policy. Yeah?
What's your view on the US becoming a major crude oil exporter in the near term?
For the time being, nothing. Zero, because there's not even a talk of allowing exports, crude oil exports. Right now they're banned. And they have been banned since the 1970s. So all the US operators now are trying to find ways of bypassing the ban, basically. Not illegally. In legal means, what you can do from the US is export as many refined products as you like. But the kind of crude that comes out, which is light sweet crude, they try to put it in a very simple or topping refinery to just split into the very basic products like gasoline and diesel, etc., and then start exporting it. But this is not the oil, unfortunately, the oil that comes now out of the US, out meaning from the fields produced, is the wrong type of oil, their own oil quality, for the type of refining capacity that they have installed over the last 10-15 years in the US, particularly in the US Gulf area around Texas. Because what they did is they put what we call complex refineries, expensive refineries that can take any type of crude oil, the very, very thick, dirty crude oil, the heavy and sour crude oil, which comes out of Venezuela, which comes out of Canada, and so on and so forth. And they don't really like the good quality oil because they cannot get a profit, a refining profit out of it. So right now they are in a bit of a muddle in terms of what to do with the crude oil. They can start exporting the gas, but this is not until 2017, I think. They are building the LNG terminal now. But an LNG terminal is a big business. You know, it costs you between $7 to $10 billion. Billion dollars, yeah?
Same note, if the US does start exporting LNG to Europe, like by the time it gets there, it's already quite close to the European price. Do you think Russia just then will undercut their own gas to Europe?
I personally think that the gas will not come to Europe, other than a couple of pilot trips. There's much better price to get if you sell it to Japan. And now that the Panama Canal is expanding, by the time that this LNG exports will realize, they can it will be able to accommodate the biggest LNG carriers like the QMAX. Okay, so I think the flow is going to be Asia-Pacific, where you can get $18 per million BTU rather than $10-$11 per million BTU that you get in Europe. And you're right, by the time you put liquefaction and transportation cost on the price of Henry Hub gas, it will probably come to about the same price that it's traded in Europe. So I don't think we're even going to go there.
And then at the same time,
oil is already looking towards the Asian market. The first thing that they did was put in signing the big agreement with the Chinese about the gas pipeline, because there's a lot of what you call stranded gas in eastern Siberia, small gas fields, but not enough pipeline connection. So once they do all these sort of small lines, feeder lines, into a big pipeline, then they can export it straight to China. They already do it with the ESPO, which is the oil pipeline. So absolutely, the whole idea is right now Russia exports something like 7 to 8% of its gas to Asia Pacific, which is very, very small. The rest of it goes to West Europe, plus the former Soviet Union republics, you know, Ukraine, Belarus, etc., etc.
Go on. Considering their history with LNG projects, do you think Russia will, you know, successfully get involved with Asian LNG markets on time?
You can get your crystal ball and you can give me the answer. You know. But they have the resource, they have the reserves. Okay, after what they did you see Shell moving out of Russia? No, because they also need the reserves. So in the end, they stayed in and they became minority partners, and they are managing the technical side of the Sakhalin project. Okay, so, and indeed, did you see Exxon moving out of Russia? No, they are still there, exploring the Arctic together with Rosneft. Okay, so there may be the politics on the sort of the front page of the newspapers, but when it comes to the business behind it, the business ties are not, are not severed so easily. And that's why a lot of people thought that the response, if you like, to whatever Russia did with Crimea was rather lukewarm, sort of banning 20 people from traveling to the United States. It hasn't exactly stopped diplomatic relationships, has it? Okay, so you have to be a bit cynical, you know, when it comes to politics, but it's because there's business behind it. Any other questions? Okay, we're bang on time, 3:30. So you're ready for your next, what's next?
Coffee break now.
Coffee break. I need one. Thank you all very much.